Hey, what's going on, everybody? This is Spooks McGee. This is episode 3 of the Late Bloomer podcast. Right now, I'm sitting in my backyard on a Facebook Live doing absolutely nothing, watching people watch me record the intro to the podcast. It's kind of surreal. Anyway, we did not talk about COVID-19 on this podcast because I feel like we're super oversaturated with this, and plus it wasn't really that high a topic at the time when we recorded it. My special guest today is Yamin Semali. He is a dope MC, producer, writer, to name a few things. You know, representing East Pernt. Straight from out of NC. Did beats with Corrupt from the Dog Pound, Headcrack, Era Black, Stacey Epps, Eddie Meeks, Cannibal Ox, Child MC, Drugs, Count Bass. You know, just doing the damn thing. And not only that, he's a funny dude. So listen to us talk about how we remember things that a little bit too fondly than they actually are. This episode is brought to you by PURECOMP. PURECOMP's new project Clinical is out right now, and if you get a chance to check it out on the YouTube video, we'll put a link in the comments, and on the Facebook page, we will also put a link in the description of the podcast post. This should probably be up on the second or third of April. So be safe out there, wash your hands, and enjoy the podcast.
Keeping it organic.
What's going on, y'all? This is the Late Bloomer Podcast. This is Spooks Mikey. I'm here with, I have a guest. Wow. 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 Was it, almost? Wow.
Wow. Amazing.
Wow. All right. This is, Yamin Semali. No. No, you got Yamin Semali in the building.
What up? What up, man?
Man.
What do you go by on here, man?
Man, I go by Spooks McGee. I'm Spooks McGee, you know? Okay. I mean, I've been building the brand for 20 damn years, so I might as well try to fucking, you know, capitalize off of some shit that I've been building for so long. So yeah, it's the Late Bloomer Podcast with Spooks McGee.
Boom. That has a nice ring to it.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, yeah. I mean, I feel like there's a lot of shit that me being a 30-something year old, I don't know how old I am. I stopped counting after 30. But I every time I have to Google it, I think I'm 32. I'm not sure. But there's a lot of shit that I should have listened to, watched. I just saw, I was going to mention Purple Rain.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw that. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No shade, no shame. I watched it like almost every day as a kid. on VHS.
Oh, wow. So yeah. You're just telling your age, huh? You watched it as a child on VHS. Oh,
I mean, you know, if your parents still keep VHSs, you could be a kid today still watching stuff on VHS. So I don't know if I gave it up too
okay,
much.
Okay. Well, tell the people who you are, where you come from, what you represent, what you be on, what you be up to. Because I know you've been pretty prolific in doing some things and some shit and some stuff and some writing and some this and some that and some whoop-de-whoop and some rah, rah,
rah, rah. That's a good, yeah. That's basically what my Wikipedia page says verbatim. I see somebody's been doing their homework. I'm also in the 30-plus club. I'm an MC, producer, DJ. I've been lessening my DJ role lately because I just need more time to do the other things.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So, you know, you can catch me with a lot of bars and production credits.
What about your latest release that you just dropped?
It's actually
Old thing that you just re-released.
New, old, new.
Yeah.
It's the 2.0 version of my first album that came out in 2013. It's just called Yamin.
What are the differences that you did? Did you, like, remix some of the records or what?
Some of the songs got remastered. I took off some. I added some new ones, and I remixed a couple of the old ones.
Okay.
So I got you know, it's basically all my production, all my rhymes. I got a couple features. I got some songs on there that was kind of in the nebulous zone of not really released, but previously released. I just officially made it streaming.
Right, right.
I got a song called Change Your Style with Superstition and my man Elevated Dan.
Elevated Dan.
Yeah, that was just kind of out there. I actually have a remix of that song with Corrupt from the Dog Pound.
Dope.
Big Vision from Dungeon Family.
Beautiful.
I'm going to have to re-release that again, too, because I never was streaming either.
But, right, right.
Got John Robinson on there, my man Day Tripper from Difference Machine.
Right, right.
And Truth Be Cold, my boy from King Apparel. Couple good features on there. You know, my discography as a solo artist probably started in 2012 with an instrumental project. And I've been going and doing different projects since then, from the rhymes to the beats. And
right, and I've been enjoying a lot of your work, man, I can tell that from the beginning, from the inception, what I've been hearing is pretty much that you value a specific level of quality. Like, there's no, oh, well, let's just put it out, see what the fuck. No, it's going to sound fire every time. It's not going to be no trash. It's not going to be no half-assed and shit. It's just, like, sparse. It's beats. It's fucking scratching. It's fucking, you know, it's hip-hop. It's just, it hits, you know?
Thank you, man.
And I feel like a lot of cats just... They call it in. They just fucking.
It's kind of a cool thing to not give your all right now.
Right.
It kind of shows how antisocial and I guess internal suffering that you have. You know, it's kind of cool right now. It's like in vogue to not be like passionate.
Yeah, I was just thinking about this the other day. I was saying, like, you know, being obsessed with something is a thing that we don't do anymore. Like people would just, like, pick a thing, and then that's what the fuck they would do forever. Like, for, like, 10 years, they would just be like, hey, yo, I'm all about fucking green hats. I'm the green hat guy, you know what I'm saying? Every nigga that got a green hat, give me the green hat, and my green hat collection is popping.
Right.
And collectors are a rare thing nowadays because what do you need to collect it for? You need to go seek shit out for because everything just comes to you. That's give it real. To you. It's whatever. They just, you know, digital. I feel like the way that we consume media nowadays is like, king of the castle, I'm the king of my throne. Look at me. Yes. Big man on the throne. Look at me. Give me more music. Give me more media. Give it to me. I want to have it. Yakshaman. Nobody knows fucking Borat anymore.
Yeah, for real. It's been a minute. But,
yo, real talk. Yo, I think that if Sacha Baron Cohen decided that he wanted to take his Julian character and make like a full album, he totally could do that.
Oh, yeah.
Because that Move It record, like, he was snapping. He was rapping on the shit. Like, nice time tweet. I ain't looked it.
That was him doing that voice?
He did the voice, yeah. You didn't know that, did you?
You didn't see Purple Rain. I didn't know that. So,
there's a lot of useless information that I have in my brain that I don't need to know. But, yeah. I mentioned Purple Rain because this is the Late Bloomer podcast. I want to talk about some shit,
right.
But it also is going to help me to understand, to talk about some shit that has been on my mind lately.
Right.
The themes that are in the film, domestic violence.
In films?
The themes that are in this particular film.
Purple Rain.
Idea of domestic violence, the idea of the continuous cycle. Like, he's doing the same shit that his dad was doing, da 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 da. You know, the idea of fame. Wanting fame. The idea of being the most 80s nigga. Like, I feel like that dude is the most 80s nigga. Like, it didn't matter that he was saying the corniest shit. Like, the fact that he was the most 80s
nigga. He embodied a decade.
Right. But then Prince's character was the kid, right? Mm-hmm. Was the most... He just, like, his aura, his essence, his aesthetic superseded the 80s. So, in real life, his shit superseded the 80s as well.
Yeah, no doubt.
And
he was an asshole in that movie.
Yeah, and the character in the movie, but the idea of the visual, the idea of how he carried himself, it transcended the 80s, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And so I feel like that is a really cool representation of people in general, you know?
Word.
Because think about it, like, you know, the dude that mastered being the coolest nigga, like, he spent so much time figuring out how to be that nigga at that era that he ends up being stuck in that era.
Hmm.
And the individual motherfuckers, like, always supersede the era. Like, they transcend any genre, any style, any era.
Yeah.
And anything that's happened, they could put their little hot sauce on whatever's happening at the moment. You know what I'm saying?
Sounds like Prince.
Yeah. Right, right.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's the man. Yeah.
And I did not... Okay, here's the thing. Being a kid... who was sheltered, he didn't listen to a lot of music, I'm super unfamiliar with Prince's catalog, right? Mm-hmm. And I understood Prince was skilled at what he did, but I didn't understand exactly how good he was.
Word, yeah.
Because I just never knew. I
probably still wouldn't if it wasn't for my... I have avid Prince fans in my family.
That's what I'm saying. You know, so my family was not, like, worldly, quote unquote. So I didn't hear a lot of, you know, popular music. And if they did listen to some shit that was, like, you know, like, big, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. So my knowledge of music was limited to whatever I heard on the radio. So the whole Prince versus Michael Jackson thing, Michael Jackson had a wider reach, and he was more effective in that regard. But Prince, in my opinion, would shit on him any day when dancing and producing and singing and and whatever.
Instrumentation,
everything.
You noticed, you heard the story about they were supposed to be on Bad.
Yeah, I hear that. I mean, these stories, you never know what the fucking truth is. Because he goes, well, first of all, the first line in that song is, "Yo, but it's mine."
Yeah. Yeah, which
and
is
I ain't
facts.
Having that. It's like, ah, come on, y'all niggas be just telling stories. I don't know what's what, like, and I've learned not to take shit too seriously. I want to take shit with a grain of salt. I don't really know whether or not something would be considered like for sure, like without a doubt, a fact.
Yeah.
And being a person who has studied like theology and like religion and starting to understand that, I'm starting to see that stories can be conflated and misconstrued
over time
to make it more interesting. Yeah. So
you gotta, nobody was like, Mike ain't around to be cross-examined on that.
Yeah.
So neither one
take,
of them are.
Right. We take it for what it is, you know. We don't know if Jesus actually had the bread and what happened?
The fish. And
it could have been a piece of chicken, you know what I'm saying? And some pasta
some
fowl. We don't know. But you know, we said fish and bread, then we just had to stick with fish and bread. That's what we had to stick to. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, I got like mad theories on that.
Yeah. I mean, we could do all that, but I'm not trying to do that today.
Is that representing Pisces? Is that entering the Piscean age?
Two
fish?
Right. Was Jesus actually a carpenter? Because according to his location, there wasn't very many trees. So I mean, like, where did he get the wood from? Like, what the fuck? You know what I'm saying, like, there's just so much shit you could do and really like challenge. Like, and what one of the things about why I wanted to do this shit was to think about what is considered a normal thing, like having kids and getting married, and challenging it specifically to piss you off. And so, I was thinking about this the other day. There's so much shit that we just accept as fact, and we'll go, "Oh, that's a classic." When it comes to music
and stuff.
It's like, "Oh man, Nothing Lasts Forever" by Keith Sweat is a classic.
Oh, man.
It's like, this is the best song ever. And one of the things that really fucking had me going, and I was ranting and raving about this shit, is how did we as a society allow Soul for Real Candy Rain to happen? Like, it's a bop. Listen to me. If it comes on, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
When it comes on, I'm doing the fucking running, man. I'm doing the wop. You know what I'm saying? I'm moving. I'm shaking. But, bro, come on. The song is trash.
What's your problem with that song?
The song is trash, bro.
I'm trying to think of the
Okay, first of all, the first lyric, it goes, "My love."
Mm-hmm.
Now, first of all, do you ever address anyone that you talk to as "my love"?
My love.
My love. My love. You know, someone really wrote these fucking lyrics. Matter of fact, yo, let me pull this shit up, bro. Hold on. Let me pull this shit up. Yo, "My love," okay? And then first off, you lead in asking her a question. Do you ever dream of candy-coated raindrops?
What?
Nigga, the fuck is you talking about? What's she gonna say to you? She gonna say, "Do I ever dream of what, nigga?" Yeah,
that's some slang.
Yeah. "Do I dream of candy-coated rain? You trying to nut on my face, nigga?"
Right. Rain on me.
You trying to rain on my... You trying to put some candy coats on my...
That was around the same time the SWV Rain Down on Me joint came out, I think, right?
Yeah, but also, that was around the same time when Barney was popping. Uh-huh. Big purple... big a nigga in a big-ass purple suit, right? Talking about... "If all the raindrops were lollipops and gumdrops, oh, what a thing that would be." So my nigga, like, you thinking about candy coated raindrops like Barney and his squad, right?
No, I don't think that's the same.
It's not the same. However, he's saying, "Have you ever dreamed of candy coated rain?" Like, are you that much about sugar? Like, I don't even eat candy that much, bro. Like, this is stupid. Like, what the fuck are you talking about, nigga? What is you talking about? Candy coated rain?
Yeah, I mean, you taste the rainbow. Man. They was cross promoting.
First of all, I never dreamed about candy ever. I never was like, oh, what if all the stars and the moon and the sky were like a big lollipop?
The moon is just a big cookie. What
if the moon is a cookie and the stars are sprinkles? The stars are sugar and it sprinkles in the sun and the moon. And then, okay, all that shit, fuck all that shit, right? Then he goes, oh, then she, so let's say that she actually does go for it. Oh, yeah, sometimes I do think about that, yeah, right? He goes, well, how about this? How about this? I want to drop this on you. Sometimes I think about that too, and it makes me think of you because you're the same as Candy Coated. Panty dropper!
She didn't see that coming.
She didn't see it, bro. It's dumb. It's not a bar. It's not even suave. It's not cool.
You're the same.
Bro.
My candy
rain. So, have you ever dreamed of Candy Coated raindrops? You're the same as that.
Is that a rhetorical question?
Yeah. First question. Candy Coated rain is to you at nigga the fuck. Okay, so then it goes on to play the first bar. Hold on, I'm gonna get the lyrics for this shit. Hold up. Candy rain, soul for real, right? Now I'm gonna tell you, have you ever loved someone so much that you thought you'd die? Giving so much of yourself, it seems the only way.
What's the only way to die?
I don't know. Like, what's this, Romeo and Juliet, nigga? Like, this is stupid.
Tell me what you want.
Tell me what you want, and I will give it to you, because you are my dream. You are my love. Look, okay, first of all, honestly, I'm going to ask you a question, except for, like, your kids or your parents or something. Have you ever loved someone so much that you would die?
No.
Ah, come on, bro. Nah. Jesus died for your sins.
I love somebody so much, I thought I wanted to kill him.
I've loved someone so much I wanted to live so I could love them some more.
Word, there you go.
Right. First of all, these bars don't even fucking rhyme. And you know what I noticed? Love by Music Soul Child does not rhyme. Did you know that? Love by Music Soul Child does not rhyme.
Just the whole song?
The whole song.
I can believe that.
Think it. Love, so many things I got to tell you, but I'm afraid I don't know how. Because it's a possibility that you look at me differently. Yeah. Love doesn't rhyme.
Yeah, that's just
it just works because it's in a nice cadence. Love back. Right.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the, what's his name? Fonte verse where he doesn't rhyme the whole verse, right? So what I'm saying is sometimes not rhyming is good, right?
Yeah,
but someone actually wrote this. Someone said, a songwriter, because these are kids, they didn't write this.
Mm-hmm.
They've never loved someone so much that they feel like they're going to die. So someone wrote this shit. Someone sat down and said, here's the lyrics. Here's the bars.
I kind of can rock with a song that don't rhyme, though, if it's dope. Like, Prodigy used to do that a lot.
Yeah, I feel it. Like I said, sometimes, just like Prodigy, just like, you know, Fonte, just like the Music Soul Child, there are instances where not rhyming is good.
Mm-hmm.
This is not one of those.
This is not it.
So I'm going to tell you why Candy Rain works, in my opinion, right?
Okay.
Because it plays on a bunch of different themes and ideas that we want. We want to be young and nubile and virile and horny, and it makes us think about high school, right?
Buck wild.
Yeah. So first of all, it's super weird that you're like looking at these young men going, "Oh, that's so sweet. He's talking about love." And then, what the fuck? And then the second thing is they play on nostalgia.
Right.
Okay, so they got the Tribe Called Quest. Oh my, what's the beat? My god, yes.
Nah,
oh my god.
Nah, you mixing songs.
No, what now. Song is that? What song is that?
Fuck. You're on point, fight.
On time tip. Can I kick it?
No. Man, I feel like it's been a long day, man. I've been rapping all day into a camera.
Well, whatever that song is, it plays on that, right? Because as soon as you hear the sample, you know it's a bop, right?
Yeah.
Then, if you actually listen to the song, hold on. Alexa, play Candy Rain by Soul for Real.
Candy Rain by Soul for Real.
Soul for Real. All right, listen to this. First of all, what is that nasty ass plinky plinky?
I was trying to
trash
that, actually.
Trash.
Check the Rhyme is the name of the song.
Check the Rhyme. I was right?
Did you say that?
I said, oh my God.
You said, oh my God.
Yeah, check the Rhyme. Right. So, do you hear... Hold on. Alexa, start the song from the beginning. This is like some stock shit that you hear on the fucking keyboard
ding,
when you
ding,
first...
Ding, ding.
Somebody's playing...
Ding, 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 ding.
Right? And then listen to the strings. Listen to the string. Shitty stock strings that you get on the fucking program when you first download.
It was their first single, bro. They were supposed to just...
No. Alexa, stop. It was there for a single, but you think that these kids were sitting there producing it themselves? No. A grown-ass man thought about these plinky little things and the drum loop, and then that was it. They was like, so basically it's this. It's the plinky plinks.
Right.
It's the sleigh bells. It's the shitty-ass strings, and it's that bass line from the Check the Rhyme. The
Minnie Riperton Inside of My Love.
Inside My Love sample. Yeah. Right. That they're using not as a reference to Inside My Love, but as a reference to... the Tribe Called Quest, because Tribe just came out with that record before.
Yeah.
So, and then on top of that, it talks about, listen to the harmonies. It's basic as fuck. And the kids, the vocal performances of the kids is like whiny. Alexa, play the song. Alexa, play Candy Soul My For Real.
Candy Soul
My whole mind is fucked up. Alexa.
Play For Real.
Play Soul For Real, Candy Rain.
She's not even checking for you now.
Alexa. Play Candy Rain by Soul For Real.
I can't find Candy Rain by
Bitch.
Alexa. Are you stupid? Alexa, play that shit. Are you fucking dumb?
Stupid.
I'm not sure.
It was the Dominican stupid.
All right.
Stupid.
Alexa. Play the fucking song, Alexa. The fuck? Alexa, play Candy Rain by Soul For Real.
Candy Rain by Soul
For Real. Why'd she say it like that? Candy Rain by Soul For Real.
Wasn't there a remix of this?
There was, and it had Heavy D on it.
Or was that the other one that every little thing you do?
No, that had Heavy D on the remix.
Every little thing you do. That's the other song.
No, the remix had Heavy D on it.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
I got nothing.
Do you hear the sleigh bells?
Yeah. Aww.
You're the same. Listen to his vocals.
Didn't these guys like rob a bank or something?
Did they?
Ask Alexa that. I can Google that.
Google
one.
That, please.
I'm pretty sure they got caught up on some armed.
Alexa, be quiet. Oh, sorry, I shit my pants because I was a little baby and I'm sitting singing a song about grown shit. So anyway, this was a thing that people don't do anymore, which is super weird that we actually did do this in the past, was little kids, right, singing about grown people shit.
Right, like the Jackson 5.
The Jackson 5, Michael Jackson based it, so I'll be there. All that shit, bro, was based on this whole idea of little children singing about stuff, and that's low-key like pedo type shit, dog. Like, what the fuck? Why are we doing that, and why did we think that shit was cute back in the day? Oh, he thinks he's so grown. Like,
I got a heart as big as Texas. I'm like, word?
No, you don't, little nigga. Your heart is very, very delicate, and you better calm the fuck down. If you get too excited, you might have a heart attack at 5 years old, 6 years old, talking about some grown woman.
Oh, let me, hold up. Let's see.
Okay.
These dudes were doing identity theft. They were leasing at least 4 other apartments under aliases. They estimated that they struck over 260 victims in at least 8 banks for as much as $1 million.
Get the fuck out of here.
And it was in Georgia. It was in Duluth.
Wow.
Dang.
Have you ever robbed someone like a million times? So much money that I stole. Stole. They're gonna change their name from Soul For Real to Stole For Real.
Stole For Real. Oh god, that's been under our nose for 10 years.
Oh my gosh. 11. So the whole idea of Soul For Real is just like really shady, shitty business model. It's like, hey, let's get 4 kids and let's teach them the song and teach them the steps.
Right.
And
right.
The whole shit is fucking dripping with janky promoter.
little exploitation.
Yes.
Perhaps.
And so why was this okay? Why did we still sit there and go, so I'm why do people do this? I'm people. First of all, I'm one of the niggas that would be jamming for that shit. Like, if it comes on, it's We in the club. It's our fucking Sweet Caroline.
Yo, you know, a lot of songs actually are cool to me that I couldn't stand when I was a kid.
Toward the mic a little bit.
Oh, my bad.
I know it's a condenser mic and it can pick up mad vocals.
Yeah, I'm hearing myself.
Hella far away.
Yeah, I probably do sound ghostly.
But you're a rapper, so you're like, you're an MC. You're
I
like,
project.
Yeah, you project. Project.
I'm projecting, son.
Yeah. But what you were saying, a lot of things that you didn't like as a kid?
I'm starting to like have a little bit of affinity for it. even if it is just the nostalgia.
Right.
Like, you know, T-Bird, my baby daddy. I used to want to throw up when I heard. I used to want to throw up when I heard Who You With.
I actually know the dude who wrote that.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, certain
white
songs.
Guy.
Really? He needs to get the fuck out of here.
Yeah,
serious?
He's a white guy. Yeah. You would never thought that he wrote that, but go ahead.
Wow. He's like that dude who wrote some Marvin Gaye shit. Sexual healing and shit.
Yeah, yeah.
But just certain songs from the past that I didn't really give too much airplay when I was 8, 9, 10, listening to Wu-Tang, but
right.
I didn't like the radio like that. But now I'll hear certain joints and I'll be like, oh man, remember this? Like,
right.
When Nas Wright comes on, you know what I'm saying? I'll bang that loud. Like,
right.
You know, certain stuff has an effect on you, like how you do that. Yeah, Young Bleed. You know, because I wasn't a super No Limit fan either as a kid, but right. Certain joints come on now, like Make 'em Say On Remix, like, yeah. Like,
and I heard recently, Project Pat, Chicken Head Ho, and that shit slapped too, because that shit.
Yeah. I could when that came out, I could not believe that that was. I thought
it was a mainstream appeal.
I was like, "Yo,
there's no way!"
It just sounded like two slaves having a joning contest.
Well, yeah, it kind of does.
It's just a meter, bro. Yeah. You know, man, shut the fuck up.
Why you need some gum? it sounded like the crows from fucking Dumbo.
Yo, it sounded like mad.
But that's
stereotypical.
But that's their culture. See, some people are stereotypical. And that's okay.
And that's okay. And
but
that's, okay.
That's just because that's who they are. Like, some people are doing a thing, and some people are genuinely that. That's really how they are.
How they, yeah.
Right. So, yeah. I don't know if you'll notice, but if I'm ever doing music, I'm never going to pretend like I'm super hood. But nah. I'm a hood dude. Like, I do think like that, you know?
It worked.
But like you said, like, there are a lot of records that I didn't understand or didn't fuck with as a kid that now I do.
Yeah.
And a lot of it is, like, corny shit, like cornball shit. Like, I really like that Blue Double D song. That shit rides if you actually listen to it.
Wait,
Blue Double D, Double D. It's like a house song. You know what I'm saying?
The chick who's singing that?
No, it's a dude. And then in the video, they used to put it on the box. They used to have like aliens dancing and shit like that.
I don't even think I heard that.
Or Smash Mouth. Like, whenever I hear
some,
I know what the next part is. Body once told me. But I listened to that song recently and I was like, okay. It's
not
a cheesy
sharpest
song.
Tool in the shed.
Yeah.
Whatever.
No, it's decent writing, it's decent song structure. Uh-huh. It has DJ scratching, it incorporates pop, it incorporates like live, you know, instrumentation. So yeah. I see why it would be like considered like the perfect
mass
pop song.
Appeal,
yeah. And so I appreciate that, but I still know that it's objectively
shit.
Bad. Yeah. But I start to look at things like that as an older person, as a musician and somebody who starts to understand like the structure and understanding like how to create a song.
Mm-hmm.
That these things, I know I start to think about why they work. And why they're good, or why they're bad, or why they're, you know, or like, so that's the thing. Same thing with So For Real. Like, So For Real is a bad song. Overall, if I was
Candy
a producer,
Rain is a bad song.
Candy Rain is a bad song. If I was a producer and I was listening to it and I was like, nope. Because it's the thing, you can't go, oh, that was the time.
It just had to be
because
kids, man. Like, imagine LSG singing that song. It would have been weird.
Right. Exactly. It wouldn't have worked if it wasn't kids.
Nah.
But as a person, you can't just go, oh, well, it's a 90s thing. You know?
You shouldn't.
Because there are a lot of good music in the 90s that came out around the exact same time that still stand the test of time.
And it had nothing to do with it being from the 90s.
Yeah, hold on a second.
All right. We'll be right back. We was just talking about Smash Mouth.
Right. So the only reason why it worked was because it was kids, right?
Mm-hmm.
It would not have worked if it weren't kids doing it. But...
Yeah.
There's a lot of things that are objectively bad, specifically not very good, that we really, really like because it reminds us of high school, it reminds us of the times that we were, the good times, et cetera, et cetera. So by talking about the song objectively, like as an artist and going, well, in retrospect, this is not very good. It can really upset people.
What songs can you point out maybe?
Okay, let's see.
That people have gone back and said, in droves, that man, this song really wasn't that good. What the fuck were we on?
Mambo Number 5, right?
Macarena.
Like certain shit we go back to and like, what the fuck?
What were we thinking? This was a phenomenon.
She bangs?
Oh my gosh.
Anything that came out of the American Idol canon, probably.
What else did we have that was just like, it's just, this is not very good at
but
all.
But it went off when they dropped.
Right.
Like went off.
Right.
It was everywhere. And now we can admit
right.
that we're stupid.
Here's the thing. Dos Effects created something that was fresh and never heard before.
Mm-hmm.
But in retrospect, okay, We Want Effects is pure gibberish.
It's like a bunch of cliches.
It's essentially just a bunch of people sitting around watching, doing nothing but watching cartoons and commercials,
and jingles.
You know, it's super dated because it's like if you listen to it, you got to have the fucking genius open to understand what they're talking about.
Because a lot of them ads,
it's
don't
like
run.
Reference after reference after reference after reference.
That's what Method Man's whole shit was.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying too. So it's like. Now I like people who talk about just general things instead of like referencing popular culture.
Yeah.
And so that in its essence is a bad thing because it just it dates you.
It dates
you and it doesn't make your music timeless. I don't think that you can listen to a Lauryn Hill record from 1999 and go, well, who is Porgy and Bess? I mean, that's probably the only thing that she really references. Yeah. That I can think of that's a dated reference. Like,
yeah. It's the best MCs kind of keep it timeless. I think about that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I even try not to complain a lot in music.
Yeah.
You know, because I don't want to like immortalize the complaint.
Right.
So I get that. But yeah, like certain stuff you had to be there. And you're just not gonna like it like that unless you was there or you have some other type of connection to it.
Yeah.
But with a lot of those type of rhymes, when you're talking about Dos Effects rhymes with like the, you know, commercial jingles that they would incorporate. You know, them commercials don't run no more. Them brands might not exist no more.
Right.
And you might even think it sounds cool. Like, oh man, that little melody he had right there was hard. That might have been a commercial for a biscuit that don't.
Yeah.
That stopped being produced in '92.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's like a bunch of random, like it's almost like Easter eggs.
In
rap.
Yeah.
It had a lot more of that going on.
Right. And I do appreciate that. Because what happens is it starts to rejuvenate things. But I appreciate it more when they do it and they're doing it about a thing. Like they're doing it about a song, they're referencing other songs.
Because
it's low-key like a way to keep people interested in our culture, our history.
That's what we did for samples.
Yeah, different samples, different references, different like, you know, interpolations of different parts of songs. And all that shit eventually like starts to come together and make sense as far as like keeping the culture alive.
Yeah.
And hip-hop, in my opinion, is one of the few genres that references itself more than most genres.
No
so
doubt.
Like, I can't really think of, you know, an AC/DC song where they're talking about, you know, a different rocker from the earlier era, I guess would say, if we're talking about AC/DC.
Yeah, you don't really see that in rock. You don't really, certain things that are like really unique to hip hop, like saying one's name.
Mm-hmm.
Or like the producer's name. Like,
yeah.
Just that whole bag, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
we that's new. It gets tiresome sometimes to hear that.
Yeah.
Like, sometimes we want to break out of it. But that's our thing. We created that.
Yeah, but this is the thing. Like, back in the day, doing a cover song of a song that was popular was not a big deal.
Then
you wouldn't hear, like, Satchmo go, like, shout out to Louis for writing this one. Shout out to Miles for writing this one. You know what I'm saying? Like, it just doesn't happen. You know what I'm saying?
You a fool for this one, Miles.
You a fool for this one, Miles. So yeah, I totally fuck with it. But what I wanted to talk about was how the movie. Did I say this before, or did we just say it off thing? I think we already mentioned it.
What's that?
About how Purple Rain talks about certain things. Did we mention that?
We did. We talked about the domestic abuse.
Right.
What else? About just him being an asshole character.
Right.
The
but,
kid.
Right. But there's something else that I noticed in the movie. Right, and this goes back to, you know, back in the day when people would reference things.
Yeah,
is that there's a deliberate reference or call out to this Abbott and Costello bit, who's on first,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
Now, if
yeah.
you know about that, then it makes sense. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It makes sense that they're doing the who's on first
the
bit, right?
The password.
Yeah, the password section. Yeah. Uh-huh. So the whole password thing. But imagine just being a random hood dude watching a movie and you don't understand the origin of the one of the oldest comedy bits of all time.
Yeah.
Right? They're doing the bit. The writers know that they're doing the bit. Everyone knows that this is a version of who's on first, right?
Uh-huh.
And a lot of films have that. They have this version of a thing, that, of a trope that's been done a million times.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not uncommon. Oh.
Watch your headphones.
Like. Yeah. It's not uncommon for that to happen. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no doubt. And yeah, and it might fall deaf or, you know, somebody might be, they might miss the reference, but it'd still be funny.
Right, right.
You know what I mean? So.
And it's like a wink, wink, nudge, nudge to all other writers and people who write scripts. And
yeah.
Like
yeah.
Yeah. But I was thinking about the movie in general and the idea that you know, people can be like the most, did I talk about this? I feel like we talked about
which part?
How you could like you could be the most 90s dude.
Oh yeah, we talked about that part.
We did.
Uh-huh.
Okay. I don't know where I'm going. But anyway, yeah, man. So, hey, so this is the part where I was going to mention another sponsor, but I don't have any sponsors right now because everything is shut down, and those two sponsors are event planning companies, and they're all shut down until, like, September. Anyway, but I do want to say stay in the house and do not go out to the club or to your friend's house to play spades because you may be asymptomatic and you may carry the disease even though you don't know that you're carrying the disease. And I have a slight feeling that many of us have carried the disease already. I don't know if we're still contagious or not, but again, just be very careful. Wash your hands and wash your ass. Get some dope merchandise from paidinamerica.com. That's one thing I can tell you to do. Hats, sweaters, coats, cell phone covers, dope shit. Paidinamerica.com with 3 K's. Back to the show. Yeah. Yeah, we're back with Yamin Semali.
Yo.
And man, you remember that?
Like yesterday.
It was beautiful. It was amazing. It was the best thing that ever existed.
But it wasn't.
Right. And that's the thing that I'm starting to realize is that most of the shit that we remember as the good old days, the best of times, the worst of times, it more than likely was the worst of times.
It's absolutely horrible.
Dude, everybody remembers the time that they were growing up is the best time. Like,
yeah.
The best music, the best food, the best girls, mm-hmm. Everything was the best. And I'm starting to realize that dude, our memories don't serve us very well.
Yeah.
We remember what the fuck we want to remember.
That's how we lie to ourselves,
dude.
So we don't feel like we're missing anything now. Like, we got all the good shit back then.
Oh, man, back in my day.
Yeah.
That
yeah,
whole
I'm
back
missing.
In my day shit, dude.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh, dog.
I don't want to ever be on that. I've realized this many times. I'd never go back to any previous year I've lived. Like, oh, I want to be younger. Like, nah, I'd never feel like that. I'm always like, fuck that year.
Yeah.
Like, my life, yo, I'm like, nah, I'm doing better now. Even if I wasn't, I know better or
yeah.
whatever. So, I never want to go back to a place where I was, like, mentally not where I am now.
Yeah.
It just seems like regression.
I think that what it is like, we sit in, like, a fantasy world, right?
A lot of times.
Where we could think about, like, all the stuff and remember it, and we could create our own little, like, world. Like,
mm-hmm.
It's, like, kind of like, I don't know how to explain it. It's, like, you know, it's like an escapism to a degree.
Yeah,
instead of thinking about what's happening now in the future and what's going on around you, just sitting and reminiscing and finally remembering the past,
mm-hmm.
Because that's an easier way to, I don't know, cope with what's happening now, is to just remember what was. Oh, man, that shit doesn't go nowhere, man. And I catch myself doing that coulda, shoulda, woulda, or what happened, but all that shit is just pointless,
just,
bro.
Just keeps you stagnant.
Yeah,
or going
exactly.
backwards is
exactly.
even worse than being stagnant.
Right.
But yeah, I remember, like, even as a kid, right?
Right.
Like, the comfort of having somebody make food for you because mm-hmm. you're a child and you can't you know, or somebody loves you and don't want you to eat.
Right.
You know, you might get a bologna sandwich when you was a kid, you know?
And that I remember would be the best fucking bologna sandwich you ever had.
Huh? That's what I think. This is my point I'm getting to. Like, it wasn't the sandwich that you liked. It was the fact that somebody cared for you and made the sandwich, right? But then you get older and your tastes mature, and you realize bologna tastes like asshole, right? And then you're like, man, I still love this person who made this sandwich. How do I get a different kind of sandwich without how can I still get the love the person gave me and get a better fucking sandwich?
Right, right, right.
So that's when you become aware and you become responsible for your own taste. Mm. So that's when you get, that's why I don't ever want to go backwards, because I feel like the more responsible I become for my own taste in life, the more I can like find out what I want to taste. Right, you know what
right,
I mean?
Right.
So it's just like, whether it be like the sandwich metaphor, mm-hmm. or like even when you was doing like your mom was doing your laundry, but then you wanted to buy certain clothes when you got older, now you had to do your laundry.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like more responsibility comes with having better things, you know? So right. like, even with my taste in music, I've had to go through so much music, I had to buy so many records. It's so much responsibility with being a taste, like somebody with good taste.
Good taste, yeah, yeah.
Right. Everybody don't have the acumen to be responsible for good taste.
Right, right. And so that's why I think this whole thing that we're talking about is very effective, because you don't like it genuinely because it's good or bad. You like it because it's going to keep reminding you of that time that you watched it, right?
Right.
So it's not the thing that you're doing that's actually good. It's the thing that surrounded what you were doing that's actually good, right? So that's why I like this whole idea of looking at things. The whole show is based on nostalgia. Looking at things with new eyes and actually looking at it objectively and really assessing, is this really a good thing, or is it just good for the time, or you know, like
a time
for that time, you know? And that's, there's a lot of things, and everyone will say artist subjective, everything is based on perspective. And you know, Purple Rain was the biggest thing, and even as corny as some of the things that happened in that film, there's a lot of things that I could like, man, the lighting is so good, the scenery is really cool, the acting, you know, is also pretty good, but there's some the parts in the movie where it's bad. And I just feel like if I was watching that stuff as a child, I wouldn't have been able to really come to these
I wouldn't have noticed anything. I'm going to tell you what I used to like off the cuff about that. I told you I watched that movie a lot as a kid because we had it on VHS.
Right, right.
The part I used to love the most was when he embarrassed Apollonia at the show when he was talking about Darling Nikki.
Yeah.
That was my favorite part of the whole movie. Right. She got so flustered when he started talking about he met her in the hotel. Oh, God.
Yeah.
I just love the fact that he chumped her ass off and nobody knew, but she knew. Yes. She got the hell up out of there. I love that scene since I was 5 years
right,
old.
Right.
I really love that scene. The scene, what's my other favorite scene out there? Well, of course, you know, Lake Minnetonka.
When my man said chili sauce and hit that slide, I said, it's the coldest nigga in the world. He's the coldest nigga alive. What's his name?
Talk about his rival.
No, his actual name. What's his name again?
Oh, Morris Day.
Morris Day.
Yeah.
Morris Day in the time.
In the time, Jerome.
Yeah, but when he said chili sauce and hit that slide, I was convinced that this nigga is the coldest nigga alive.
Yeah, he's most definitely that dude. Did you ever see sidebar? You ever see Tales from the Tour Bus? The Mike Judge.
Right. Thing? Yes, it's a really good series.
So good.
Really
so good.
Yes.
Not a commercial.
I haven't seen the whole thing because I haven't paid for cable. I probably can watch it now that we have cable. Yeah. But I was watching clips of it on YouTube, and I'm like, give me more clips. And I'm like, you know.
Yeah.
It was really good. Like,
you can find it.
Yeah.
You can find it somewhere.
It's on Showtime. I'm not a pirate anymore.
Like, back in Cinemax was on.
Yeah. So that's another thing that I've let go. A lot of things that I've let go that I thought were like, you know, cool, and they're not cool. It's not fucking cool.
Pirating
it's not that illegal.
Uh-huh.
It's that as an artist, I appreciate quality. Why would I watch some shit that sounds like the sound is shit, the video is shit.
No doubt, it'll annoy you.
I appreciate good quality content. So the fact that I even did it as much as I did is dumb. It's bad, right?
I totally agree though. I feel you. It's about being like an audiophile. You know what I'm saying?
Right. But it's a lot of things. Like, I think that things that we do that are detrimental to us as a people, and it like eating like Debbie Cakes or fucking, you know, watching bootleg movies or smoking Black and Miles or whatever the fuck you did.
Whatever, yeah. One-ply toilet paper.
Right. Some people still do those things well up into their 30s and 40s. Sometimes you just gotta let some of this hood shit go, bro, because that shit is
obvious. That's what I'm saying. That's like the whole having the responsibility for having good taste, man.
You have to, like, Colt 45 is not a good beer.
Nah, it's the bottom of the barrel malt.
But some people, you pop open that malt liquor and it's just like, back home.
Yeah.
The fuck?
Yo, because I'm so anti-chicken. And this is my thing with meat, right?
Yeah.
If it's going to kill you, if it's rare, you shouldn't eat it.
Right.
That's how I feel.
Yeah.
Like a rare steak ain't going to kill you under controlled circumstances. Yeah, you know what I mean? But anyway, I am from Atlanta. Every once in a while, I'm like, yo, I want some motherfucking wings, dog. You know what I'm saying? Then I hate myself after I eat that 10 piece.
Right.
But it's in me. I ain't going to ever claim to be vegan.
All right.
But I'd rather.
Think about that Yarbird, man. Yeah, that Yarbird. That shit going to.
I'd rather chill.
Lemon pepper wet. With the fries on the side.
I seen a lemon pepper wet sticker on a car, and it was in the image of the Ninja Turtles logo, like with the Teenage Mutant Ninja and the turtles on the arc.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Like lemon pepper wet, and the where it says turtles on the Ninja Turtles, it said Atlanta. It's like lemon pepper wet Atlanta.
But that whole thing is like, yeah, there's just a lot of things that we do that
for the culture,
or it's just like programmed in us, and we don't even realize that it's not good for us.
Yeah, like, a lot of things in our culture aren't really.
It's good not good for you. But once you know that it's not good, you understand why it being bad is also important. There's certain things that are bad that are important. You need to know that it's bad. You need to do it, and then you realize, oh, that was bad. I shouldn't have done that.
Yes,
but
and not to repeat.
Right. Yeah. So I'm an all-encompassing person. Like, I'm not for this or that anymore. Mm-hmm. I if I see someone doing some ratchet shit, I don't want to try to convince them that it's bad. I might make a comment about it, like, oh, dog, you probably shouldn't be doing that. And they're like, whatever, man.
Mind your business.
Yeah, mind your business. But then, like, you know, years down the line, you did what you were supposed to do, right?
Yeah.
If you feel compelled to say something about what they're doing is wrong, whether or not it hits them now or they're sitting, you know, in the jail cell 10 years ago and go,
right.
Man, that nigga that was in the street was right. That random dude that said something to me that day, he was right. So I don't really want immediate results all the time. I mean, right.
You know, I told you so is best served cold sometimes.
Yeah, right. Right.
I told your dumb ass. Hang up on him.
Nah. Yeah, there's a lot of things that we do that, you know, are not good for you or just dumb or just like pointless. Like, you know, Yu-Gi-Oh cards or Pokemon cards, you're sitting around a table and you guys are doing shit. It's like, okay, this is a game, this is fun, but you just wasted 8 hours.
Oh boy.
8 hours, right?
Oh my God.
Or you have a Tamagotchi or some shit and you're going like, beep, beep, beep. Oh, I have to feed my dog.
Feed my it's digital.
Like you just spent 6 hours with this digital dog to keep feeding it. And like, it's just like, there was a moment when I decided that I was going to stop playing video games. Mm-hmm. Not because I don't like video games. I love it. It's fucking awesome. I don't think that it's not going to help me as a developmentally, right? But I know who I am. I know that I do the most when I'm doing something. So if I was playing video games and it wasn't serving me or giving me an opportunity or a lane for me to be able to make money from playing video games, I had to cut that shit.
I had to stop it.
Because I knew that I would spend all my money and all my time playing video games, but I would never be involved in the field of video games. Now, the possibility of me being involved in the field of entertainment is a little bit higher because of the 6 degrees of separation and things are starting to connect and make it more sense.
Yeah.
So,
and you can still rock with the video game element through that.
Right. Yeah. And when I get older, maybe I'll buy all the systems and play them. But right now, I want to utilize my abilities as a, you know, as a talking head, as a rapper, as a producer, as a singer.
You got super talent, man.
Oh, so, thank you, bro. Yeah, thank
you. I'd be remiss to not say that on your platform, people listening, I'm sure they know. But you gave me props when I came here. So I have to also let you know that that's super mutual.
Yeah.
And I don't just throw that out there. Some people, honestly, like my music and I don't like their shit. I don't say, hey, I hate your shit. Sorry.
Right,
but
right.
I love your music, so I'm going to tell you that.
Right. Thank you. And if it was trash, I would really appreciate it if you told me
something. Yeah, I wouldn't fucking
A lot
be
of
here
people
right
don't do that. Like, they'll be like, yeah, that was dope, bro.
Yeah. I'm really...
I told myself I was gonna start being fake in 2020. It's necessary for me.
Yeah, yeah.
To be a little faker for the sake of people around me. I think because when I do give people my unadulterated peace of my mind, it wasn't really worth it most of the time anyway. So I'd rather kind of coddle people around me for just the greater good a little bit. Right. Like, I'm not going to put myself in a position I don't want to be in. Like, right. I'm not going to be in a studio session with somebody I think is whack because right. I want them to like me. But if I don't necessarily like your shit or I feel some kind of way about it, I'm not going to give you all that. I'm just going to be like, yo, man, it's cool, bro. I really see you doing good in this market. You know what I'm saying? Like, right, my fake, my phony has gone up. I'm like, man, these people in this particular genre region, they might like this shit.
Yeah, yeah.
Basically telling you I don't.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm trying to give you something positive.
Right, right, right.
I'm trying to be fake with a...
a twist.
With a twist. The new fake. You know, 2020
fake. Wet yeah. fake. But what I started realizing that it's not fake per se. Yeah. It's just protecting your energy.
Boom.
I don't... Yeah. I used to really want people to feel me. Mm-hmm. I really want you to understand what my opinion is, mm-hmm. right? But my opinion, you don't want to hear my opinion. So I'm just going to go ahead and stop. Yeah, I'm going to just go ahead and say, I'm good, love, and joy, and move on. Because I've one of my biggest problems is wanting them to feel where I'm coming from.
You can't, yeah.
Sometimes, and I could tell right off the bat, if I'm talking to somebody, and they fuck with where I'm going with this. Mm-hmm. They start to get more intrigued and ask more questions. Huh, mm-hmm. But then if I see them, their body language change, they start acting like standoffish and like, what the fuck is wrong with this guy? Then I kind of back off and I'll go. But you know, whatever, it's whatever.
Walk off.
But you know,
either way.
Yeah, I mean, you could or you can't. You know, it's whatever. Hey, to each his own. You know. But I do have very strong polarizing opinions on many topics.
Yeah.
But I don't want to be specific on whether or not I'm playing a joke up mm-hmm. or if I actually believe it.
No doubt. I mean, sometimes you want to just show people the oasis of your ideas in the desert of bullshit.
Yes.
You're like, hey, I'm not going to can't make you drink this shit. Right. I can't make you drink this water, but look at that shit. Look at that. Doesn't that water look good? Like, some, you know, you have to be right. like that with people.
Right. Sometimes. People, there's a big problem that I've noticed, and it's called groupthink.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And it's not a new thing. It's been going on forever. As long as humans
since
have
existed.
Since
there's ever been a group.
Yes. And so, I mean, the whole thing about Jesus getting crucified, the whole story is based on everyone knew that he was wrong. He was the fuck. He was the dude that was blasphemous, walking around acting like he was the shit. Mm. He was dead wrong. Kill that nigga, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. So if there are certain aspects about groupthink that does help to push people forward, but in most cases, throughout history, when things have gone wrong, it's because everybody thought that this thing was the thing. Everyone that was white in the 60s knew for a fact that you sat in the back of the bus and that was normal and that was good. Mm-hmm. And then someone said, "Nah, B." And they said, "What? Maybe you're right. It isn't good." But at one point, before they stopped and thought about the fucking
yeah.
shit,
oh man,
it was good.
So you know that experiment they did with those chimps? Okay, let me see if I can tell the story right.
Okay,
say it's five chimps in a room, right?
Yamin, the griot.
Let's come around. Sit
Anansi,
around.
Anansi, the Somali.
Anansi the Somali. Oh. All right, five chimps, right?
Okay.
There's a ladder in there with bananas hanging from the
top. It sounds like some shit you got. There are five chimps.
Five chimps.
And the bananas are sitting there.
One's name was Kofi.
One's
name was Kanan. Shut up.
Yeah, they have the most African shit. You have to listen to this story, eh?
Go ahead. Alright, so there's bananas at the top of a ladder. So
this is an actual thing or is this a parable?
No, this really happened. Okay. Scientists did this study. One of the chimps goes up the ladder to get the bananas, mm-hmm. and the scientist holds all of them down
okay.
with a big, powerful, you know, 1960s racist fire hose.
Okay.
Knocks all of the monkeys all over, all the chimps everywhere. So then they take one of the chimps out.
First off, fucked up, but go ahead.
Yeah, very, very fucked up. Tells you who's doing this.
But I say shit.
They take one chimp out, replace it with another chimp. So now it's four of the original chimps and one new chimp. The new chimp tries to get the bananas off the top of the ladder again. Mm. Then they all get hit with the hose again.
Right.
So now they take another of the original chimps out. Now you got three original chimps,
and two new chimps.
Right.
This keeps going until the cycle goes where there's only one original chimp, right? But all the other chimps are so used to every time a monkey or a chimp tries to go get the bananas, mm-hmm. they immediately make them stop because they know they're going to get hit with that water.
Yeah, yeah.
Then there's a whole group of five new chimps. Mm-hmm. Every time a chimp tries to go up the ladder and get the banana, mm-hmm. all the chimps are trying to stop the other chimp from getting the bananas off the ladder, mm-hmm. and none of them have been hit with the water hose yet. Mm-hmm. See what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah,
but they just keep doing it because mm-hmm. they saw it happen. Like, it's just been passed down. That's what
right,
we do.
Right, right, right.
Whenever a chimp tries to get a banana off mm-hmm. the ladder, we stop them because we don't know why, because it's a whole new set of monkeys at this point. You see what I'm saying?
Wow.
I might have said it a little funky.
Right, right, right.
Because it's been a minute. But that goes to the groupthink thing. It's very primal mm. that you just kind of fall in line with what you see, mm. what goes on, what's the mores of the day, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. you know, what's accepted socially. Mm. And that experiment, I always thought that was dope. I wish I knew the name of the scientist so we can kind of like look it up mm. or I could send people to it.
Yeah.
But you could probably find it, like study chimps, you know, water hoses, something like that. Google.
Yeah.
Google
I just that. Have to make sure that I spell everything correctly, because if I put monkey hose, I might get some shit. Yeah.
The placement of the S and the E is very important before or after the word monkey.
Monkey ass hoes.
Nah. Monkey ass hoes.
Volume 3. Nah. But I think that what you're talking about is basically passed on trauma.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Genetically passed on trauma, and we talked about this a while back. But basically, it's like you don't know why you're doing this, but you're doing it because you just feel that it's wrong, mm-hmm. right? And then what happens is that there's a moment where one person would go, "Wait a minute, why do we do this?
Yeah,
why is it this? Why is this the thing, right?" Mm-hmm. And then that person challenges what's the norm, and then that person becomes celebrated by challenging things, right? But when they were there, when they were doing hated. It, they were hated, right?
And they name a street after you after they assassinate
yeah, after
you.
They kill you, right? Yeah. So it's like, it's a gift and a curse wanting to be the maverick, but everyone's yeah. gonna give you a hard time in your life. And I'm not trying to liken myself to these people, but I feel that I'm naturally defiant because of my DNA and the people that I have in my bloodline. Like, you know, I'm talking about Jamaican people. I'm talking about Marcus Garvey. I'm talking about Bob Marley. I'm talking about, you know, people that specifically go against the grain. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like I don't know. It's almost in my nature to challenge the status quo and what we consider normal. You know how long Jamaica was pushing the concept of legalize it, mm-hmm. right? Before it became commonplace, yeah. where everyone is like, oh yeah, marijuana.
Before
has,
it became normal.
Yeah, it's normal, right?
Get it?
But they were chastised for it, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, hardcore.
It was the most shit. Like, and my grandmother, rest in peace, who just died this morning. And you know,
word.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. Bro,
she grew up in a society that was very divided in that regard. It's like, oh well, it's the Christians versus the Rastas, and the Bushman versus the upper class, or the middle class versus the upper class. And my grandmother, when she was living in Jamaica, was super high class, and her father forbade her to speak the patois that they spoke in the slang they spoke.
Mm-hmm.
But what I noticed was, even though my grandmother was cultured and spoke in the Queen's English, right? Whenever she was around people in that Jamaican people, she would talk and do the thing that them doing when they're talking, like they're talking and they do that and they do this.
that almost Irish joint.
Yeah. Look here, me want to do this and you have to do that. Yeah? Yeah? Huh? Why are you talking? You know what I'm saying? And so they're doing the talk, the chat.
Right, chatting.
And it's essentially you can liken it to people who have jive talk.
No doubt. Yeah. Code switching.
Yeah, code switching.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very common. It's nothing is new under the sun. Nothing is new. And so
I feel sorry for people who talk to their husbands and wives the same way they talk to their boss.
And that was one of the things that really I don't really talk too much about shit that my ex did in regards to character,
mm-hmm.
but there was one thing that I just couldn't stand for, which was the fake nice.
Mm,
you're like speaking to me in corporate speak, right?
this is very annoying, and you're being fake, and you think that you're being nice and cordial to me, but it's not a good thing to do what you're doing. This is a bad thing.
Bro, you ever see that that clip with I think it was Nikki Giovanni talking to James Baldwin about essentially that. Listeners can correct me if I'm wrong again.
Excuse me.
But I know it was James Baldwin speaking with some poet sister. I think it was Nikki Giovanni. And she was basically pleading with this dude. I mean, I know he's not into women. He wasn't into women. But I guess on a male-female thing, she was kind of pleading with the male gender to be fake at home.
Yeah.
Like the way we're fake as black men and women in the world, to come off maybe less threatening or more passive. Like, she was kind of going campaigning for us doing that in our homes, which I thought was kind of weird. You know, it's kind of one of those issues that I wish you could have seen it. We could really discourse with it. But I don't know. So what when is you the, said what is that, it made me think about it. It's like a James Baldwin. You can find it on IG. It's like a clip of him talking. And I believe it's Nikki Giovanni. Don't kill me if I'm wrong about him.
And so basically the idea was...
was that she was saying, you know, if you're going to be fake out there in the world, that's it. Yeah, that's it. She's like kind of saying, if you're going to be fake with your boss or whatever, you know, smile at me when you get home too. Don't you know. I don't know, because if you a man, you come home and the world on your shoulders, you're dealing with a bunch of shits.
Right.
You don't necessarily want to be fake with your wife. Yes, you want to tell her, yo, today was whack.
Yeah.
Like, why don't we find out a way to get up out of this
shit? Right. And one of the things that I noticed that after I did a long day of work, you know, she would ask me how my day was and want to speak to me about work. But I know that you don't want to talk to me about work.
You felt like it was like just small talk shit?
Yeah. And I also don't want to talk about work because I just came back from work. Mm. So let's not do that. Let's talk about something random. Mm-hmm. And
I'll take nostalgia over work.
Yeah, talk. Exactly. You can do that. No, now you'll talk about nostalgia. Yeah. But the thing is this.
Remember people, nerds?
Yeah. You ever yo, used to get penny candies, bro.
Right.
This is the
Coca-Cola.
Yeah. This is the member character from South Park.
Mm-hmm. Member.
They were member. They called them member berries. Member Furby.
Kids
member,
be doing member. Kids be killing member.
Yeah, but that's it's fun to do. But it's like I said, it's like you're living in a fantasy world. I'm gonna play the Baldwin clip. Here we go. All
right.
And you will if you love me. And you're going off with Maddie someplace. You're lying to me. Cause what the hell do I care about the truth? I care if you're there. What Billie Holiday say? Hush now. Don't explain.
All right, I accept that.
Of course you'll lie to me. And I don't even want to care. What does the truth matter? And why are you going to be truthful with me when you lie to everybody matter? Else?
Why are you going to be truthful with me?
You lie when you smile at that cracker down the job, right? Lie to me, smile.
No.
Treat me the same way you would treat him.
No.
I can't treat
you. You must.
This dude trying to tell you. He don't even deal with you.
And the anger. He's happy with you. Of course he doesn't know you're unhappy. You grin at him all day long. You come home and I catch hell because I love you. I get least of you. I get the very minimum. And I'm saying, you know, fake it with me. Is that too much of the black woman to ask?
Yes. You got your mind.
Right. So what I noticed was that realness is people are afraid to be real. It's like, it's almost like what we're talking about, like the escapism, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The reality of things. If you don't have a dark sense of humor, you can't find out what's funny about the reality of things.
Like you just said about doing things that are probably wrong because you needed to recognize that they were wrong.
Right. So it's like, you know, whenever I try to make a dark joke about some shit that I notice is a pattern that's also kind of low-key like a passive aggression, you know, like a microaggression.
Yeah.
I do it jokingly to mention what's happening, but it could also make someone feel that I'm attacking them, right? Yes. So it's like, I don't know what to do, right?
People are pussies.
Right, right. So me personally, right, I want you to roast the fuck out of me, right? Yeah. Tell me all the dumb shit I'm doing, and I'm going to be like, yo, I do that stupid shit, right? Yo, I got to work on that. Yeah, I got to work on that. But other people, would, instead of being like, yeah, I totally do that shit, they'd be like, I don't do that.
Yeah. And I really hate you for pointing it out.
Yeah,
yeah. I'm going to stalk you
now. It's the Gollum effect. You know what I'm saying? It's like, You do this. No, I don't. I never did that. I always do it. Sometimes I do it every day. Multiple times a day.
Rick James. Man, I never. What I look like going to somebody's house kicking their couch?
Yeah, I remember kicking it.
Yeah, I remember kicking their couch.
Yeah, it's like, you know, what the self-denial is so strong. It's so strong, bro. It's like, you know.
Tough. It's tough. I've hit people in the gut on some internet stuff before to the point where, like, they'll unfollow me on Facebook or unfriend me, but then they'll be the first person. Like, they obviously turned my posts and story notifications on because they're always the first person in my shit. So it's just like, you know, you're going to have to deal with your dirty laundry in private.
Right, right.
But I probably showed your sock off.
Right, right. Let me tell you something, dude. Like, I post whatever I feel about what's happening, and it's usually the contrarian idea, right?
No, it's nothing wrong. I think it's tempered well, it's cool. If you do it on your own page, it's cool. As long as you're not going around being like a weirdo.
Oh,
like,
going on everybody else's page and comment. That's the one thing that I killed. It's like, this is my page. Yeah. I'm curating this thing. You're trying to tell me how to make my post? Right. What the hell is wrong with you? This is my world. When you don't like the way that I'm expressing myself on this page, you can't go, well, you should have said this, right? Or I would make a joke, like a one-liner, like a Mitch Hedberg type joke, and they'll be like, well, actually,
yeah, I hate him.
Sometimes you should think about this and think about that. It's like, bro, it's a fucking joke. It's setup, punch, done. Boom, boom, it's done. Yeah. That was the bit, right? I'm not going to talk to you for 40
gonna
minutes.
Ruin my shit.
Yeah, right? It was a joke. So my idea was, I had a friend that I had known for 6 years, bro.
Uh-oh.
And he deleted me because I shared the screenshot that everyone was sharing of Young M.A. Thing where she says, oh, the reason why such and such because there's no real R&B nowadays, right? Shared it and I said, dog, do you even listen to music or do you skim through it? Because there's so much fucking R&B, it's almost comical that you would say there's none, right? Yeah. And it's good shit. Like, I can name like 40 artists off the top of my head. Like, if I go on my phone and start scrolling through, there's like 20 unique artists that are making good R&B music. Jeez. And I posted laughing, crying emoji. I can't believe y'all sharing this bullshit, dog. I know so many artists.
I seen it.
And the
shit.
Dude got literally mad. He was like, I'm sick of your shit. I don't know.
He was doing.
It's too early in the morning for this shit. I'm so sick of you. You know?
You pissed him off a long time ago, apparently.
But, I mean, it's a multi-layered thing, you know?
Yeah.
But the point I'm making is that people take that shit to heart so hard. Like, the second I notice that they're ready to start, like, going at it, I turn to troll mode. I go, you big mad or little mad?
Yeah.
You medium-sized mad or...
You're starting it.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you done fucked
because,
up
because, you know, I'm good on this. Like, we've gone past 2 or 3 exchanges, so I'm going to go ahead and stop this because I'm not going to spend the next 10 hours arguing about whether or not R&B is good when, you know, what's the point? What's the fucking point? I'm not always about trying to do something that has a point.
Yeah,
but sometimes there's some shit that's just genuinely, like, so pointless that it just serves nothing.
Yes, yeah, at this point, y'all are just showing how much you don't really like each other. And to respect each other.
Right.
Like, hey, I'm going to keep that part short because I'll always dig into a lower hole than you.
Right.
So,
I'm an MC, right? So if I really wanted to roast you, I could roast the fuck.
Exactly. People be coming to the fight unprepared.
I can fucking destroy your life with bars. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know what the fuck I'm doing when it comes to roasting. I used to watch fucking battle rap. Dog, you cannot out clown me or out roast me. I will find some shit and I would jump on that shit, right? So that's something that it's like a superpower that you have to use very carefully.
Right.
Because you can destroy a lot. It's like,
somebody want to kill you, you know.
Yeah, they want to kill you. Yeah. my ex, and I talk about, I don't want to say my ex, but you know, yeah. I mean, the problem that I had is that there's a lot of things that I feel about what you're doing and I could tell you about yourself, but I'm not going to do that because I know that it would make you feel really shit.
Especially when it started off about a Young M.A. post.
Yeah. But I mean, just like anyone, like, you know, anyone, any relationship that you're in, the just because you can destroy somebody with a roast.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily
the thing to do.
To do. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Because I know, bro, I know that you're so fucking wrong. And I know that I could get you and I could fucking make you feel like shit. Like,
cry.
But what? For what?
Just so you remember me as the guy who made you cry. Yeah.
Oh, you can't see me. I'm folding my arms.
I'm going to do a video chat.
Yeah.
Just so you can see the actual fold. Right. I'm going to do a boomerang of me folding my arms.
I did it.
Just so your bitch ass can see me.
Right.
Numerous times fading you.
And the one thing that I think about this too is that the people that really need to delete people and post about how many people they deleted and blocked. Right?
Oh, yeah, like, oh.
They have no control in their life. This is the only thing they have control over.
Yeah.
It's like...
Or somebody who, like, says, well, you can just hit that delete button if you got a problem with it. Like, when they on your shit, I'm like, oh, of course, nigga, thank you.
Yeah.
Like,
you, right, right.
All the way out of it, yeah. But so, people who have to, like, feign some type of...
Power. Yeah, like... Yeah. I'm deleting 40 people. Welcome to the club. If you're seeing this, then you made it.
Like,
you
God,
made
it, Pat.
You made the cut. It's
God,
like,
thank you.
Oh, thank you so much. Oh, I was so scared that I wasn't going to be able to see your post about, you know, what you thought about Dwayne Wade's daughter. Oh, my gosh. I really wanted to know your opinion on Donald Trump.
Yeah, it was burning a hole in
bro,
my fucking temples.
I really needed that in my life, and the fact that you made it so that I could be your Facebook friend, I'm so honored.
The stars have aligned this way.
The stars have aligned. Like, I don't really give a fuck. And so, I just hit the max Facebook friends. And
a word. You got two pages, right?
No, I only have one.
Oh, you got the music page and the junk.
And now I have, like, my business pages and shit like that. And I realized that having max Facebook friends means absolutely nothing, because all the shit that you post only goes to the people that the algorithms have curated.
Right.
So even though I got 5,000 friends, I could post something that could potentially get 100 streams or 600 likes or two.
Yeah.
And there's no rhyme or reason to it.
There's really nothing unless you pay for the shit.
Right. So I'm going to stop focusing on social media as a marketing tool in general.
It's become trash.
Yeah. It's just like, you know, I feel like if you want to do something, just curate some kind of thing that specifically targets your people, like an email list or text group chat, like
gotta
whatever. Because
grow.
It's just like, but no text group, because that shit is annoying too. Because everyone will be like, who this?
Who this?
How you text me?
Right. Text back the whole group. I hate people do that.
Bro, do you not know what this is? This is not new.
It's 2020.
What's happening? How did you get my number?
How did you get my number? Who's this? I don't remember. Who are these people? Yeah. Weirdos, man.
Bro, it's so funny. Hilarious. But, I'm going to talk to my homie, Jermaine, also known as PURECOMP. And we're going to talk to him about his new release. And so I really appreciate you coming through, bro. Real talk. And do you think this is a good place where we can end it?
Seems cool.
Do you have anything that you want to talk about or plug?
Check out that Yamin 22.0 album. I never said it out loud.
Yes, 22.0.
Yeah, 22.0. This looks like 2020. But yes. Yeah. It kind of double entendre.
Right,
like,
right.
The upgraded album 2.0 in 2020, blah, blah, blah. Check that out. Yamin, Yamin 2020. Google that.
Yeah, and we'll put the links.
The links up?
Yeah, inside of the description.
Technology, baby.
2020.
Yeah.
It's hindsight. I said it. Believe it.
Keeping it organic.
Hey, what's going on, y'all? So I just wanted to make sure that I put this last little bit of bonus material on the end of the episode for the homie PURECOMP. We have him here on the line. Of course, we can't get him in the space because of that red stripe beer virus. Hold on. We got PURECOMP. What's good, man?
What's good, man? How you doing?
That question is kind of loaded. It could be a million different ways. Right now, I guess I'm existing. I'm cool. But, you know, what about you?
Same thing, man. Black and alive. You know how it go.
Man, I was just thinking about that shit the other day. It's like, you know, being black, a black man in America, it's like shit, man. It's like, you know, you get all this shit from the world just for being yourself and trying to express yourself in the way that you like to express yourself. And then you come home and it's almost like there's no peace. It's the same thing. It's like, you know, okay, I understand that you're sad or whatever the fuck is happening to you, but it doesn't matter. You need to do this right now. And if you're not doing this, then you ain't shit. And I'm not feeling the love, like, you know, from all angles.
Yeah, facts. I agree with you 100%, man. That's just the way it is here in this country, man. Like, we wasn't ever supposed to be here in the first place. This ain't home. You're not supposed to be comfortable here. That's how I look at it.
Yeah. Because this is the thing, man. You know, a lot of niggas out here was thugging and bugging and acting crazy and doing wild shit. And, you know, I don't down that. I mean, you gotta live through your life. It's like, it's kind of like the whole phase of a thug nigga, you know? but it's like, I didn't do none of that shit, bro. Like, I lived sort of like in a position where a lot of people ended up without even having to do the thug thing. Like, I mean, like, damn, I didn't even get to, you know, bust a gun or do no crazy shit or get drunk in a strip club and fuck a stripper or some wild shit or do some coke or fucking beat somebody up. I never did none of that shit. But I'm still ending up in jail, 2 years, probation, 5 years, felony. All the shit that people who was out there in the streets doing, I ended up in the same position. It's like, damn, is anybody safe?
Nah, that's the whole thing, man. It doesn't really matter what you're doing, you know, the type of person that you are. The truth don't matter. That's what we got to realize. The truth doesn't matter. Like, for instance, if one person decides to tell everybody else that I killed somebody, right?
Yeah.
And I know for a fact that I didn't kill nobody, but this person successfully is convinced everybody else that I killed somebody, including the judge, the jury, and all of them. Guess what? I'm going to jail for that murder. Even though the truth of the matter is the fact that I didn't do shit, I didn't kill nobody. But like I said, the truth doesn't matter. It's what everybody else, it's the general consensus. That's what really matters.
So, yeah, so, you know, the fact that I'm not a criminal, and I could say I'm not a criminal, but then everyone around me is a criminal, and I go, well, I mean, I'm not like these people, but I mean, I like these people because they're interesting people, but it doesn't necessarily mean that I'm a criminal. Nothing that I say will convince them otherwise.
Nah, I agree with you, but then we got to look at the word criminal. Like, there's different types of crime.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You got violent crime, you got sex crimes, you got, you know, property crimes, all kinds of different things.
Right.
You know, corporate crime.
And that's the thing, too. It's like, you know, there's so much. Like, I was looking at the Tiger King thing, you know, and it's like, there's so much things that it takes before you actually, for certain people, before it actually becomes a serious offense. Like, imagine if I was trafficking hundreds of thousands of dollars and having all these exotic animals in my house. I wouldn't get to the point where I would have almost 200, lions or tigers. It wouldn't get that far. So, you know, it's just wild, man, because the stuff that I got in trouble with is just so minimal. It's almost comical that I could see people trafficking hundreds of thousands and almost millions of dollars worth of money doing illegal, illicit things. And it's only, you know, oh, well, you know, I'm 50 now and I got caught. So now I'm going to spend 20 years in prison. It's like, what the hell? I could have been out here wilding, like, you know, washing money, doing all kinds of crazy shit. But no, I mean, I don't understand. Like, it's just like you think about it, like, I'm not doing all the right things. I'm not like the perfect dude, but I definitely don't think that the punishment for the crimes that I was sentenced to or what I was will even match the punishment at all.
Yeah. Meanwhile, you got pedophiles doing 5 years.
Right. Right. It's crazy, man. It's crazy. And if you think about Joe Exotic, people say, well, he didn't deserve 20 years. But it's like, you know, did he deserve more? Because, I mean, he was manipulating people. He was, I don't know, man.
Man, I don't even know. I can't even tell you on that. You see what I'm saying? It ain't really my place to try to figure out, you know, what should happen in this system. I don't really pay attention to it like that. You know what I mean? I got my own
thing
that I like to focus on. You see what I'm saying? Like, and that's I don't put no trust, no faith in none of this American shit, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
That's how I look at it.
Yeah. That's how I look at it. Yeah. It's hard to really be involved in or pay attention to politics when deep, deep down you know for a fact that none of this shit is going to affect us in the short term in any way. Maybe in 15 to 20 years, but what's happening to us, like the immediate problems, like I don't have money in my bank account. I have to pay my bills. I can't get a loan. The immediate problems, they're not going to get solved no matter who you choose. And what really was made me kind of sad was before Bloomberg went through all that shit that he went through, man, where they found out that he was all kinds of racist and misogynistic and doing all kinds of crazy shit. I had spoken to some black people that were on the staff that were just like, Bloomberg's the guy. He's going to save us. He's going to change the game. And I was like kind of like being like a dick, sort of like kind of like being a troll and saying like, you know, he doesn't care about you. He's just like Trump. He's just a different brand of Trump. He's just a different kind of dude. And, you know, they was like, no, he's different. He apologized for the stop and frisk. He did all this. And then, you know, months later, all this stuff started surfacing, all the videos and stuff and him dropping out. And I just kept, and all those people that I had spoken to that were texting me trying to get me to come to their events because they liked the way that I spoke. And they were like, oh, you're so articulate and you're doing all this stuff talking about, you know, prison reform. And I really want you to come show, you know, talk to people. And I kept saying, nah, man, give me some money. I'll come through. If you like the way I talk, give me some money. They couldn't even break me up. Dude said, well, I ain't got no money neither, but I'll give you a gas money. I mean, I'll pick you up and, you know, I'll buy you lunch or whatever. It's like, bruh. So after these people that were texting me, all that shit went down. I was texting them like, "Yo, is this your boy? This the one that was supposed to save you, right?" They didn't respond. And so it's like, what's the point? Like, what is the point? What is the point of us really spending all of our time thinking about these people that really can't affect us in the way that we want them to?
Yeah, and I give credit where credit is due. Like, I don't pay no attention. I think it's a comedy when the national elections come around. Presidents, yeah, all that shit. Like, yeah, all that stuff right there is comical to me.
It's the perfect distraction.
But doing more local voting and stuff like that, for just, like, in your you know, respective towns or whatever like that you live in, your counties and all that, that stuff right there can have more of an impact. And I don't think it should be considered in the same category as the national elections and shit like that. I just don't.
Yeah, yeah.
That's just the way I look at it.
Yeah, that's something that actually can affect you. The local government stuff, that definitely has an effect on you, for sure.
It's all the same shit to me.
It's the same, but it's on a way smaller scale. Yeah, but honestly, man, I'm at the point where I'm just starting to think, like, what is the point of the president? Like, is it just a face for us to be able to see somebody to make us feel good? Because at the end of the day, I mean, I think I spoke about this on the last podcast. They had the judicial system, the legislative system, and then the other one, the executive. Yeah. And so the way that they had set it all up was so that no one really has so much, you know, absolute power, right? And everyone has to answer to someone, and they all work together to be able to come to a conclusion and to an agreement. So I really don't see the purpose of the president, like the actual person. The executive office can stand, but why do we need a face?
It's the whole thing. It's like the CEO of the corporation, man. This whole thing is a sham. Like, everything. Like, for instance, they would say that America is a democracy, right? You would agree with that, right? That America is a democracy.
That's what they say, yeah.
But when you pledge allegiance to the flag, it's to the republic for which it stands. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, all this shit is a sham, bro.
Yeah.
All the, like, if you look at how it is nowadays with Democrats versus Republicans and what black people tend to be, you know, supportive of or which party they support and things like that. But if you look back in the days, the Democrats was the one who was pro-slavery and the Republicans was quote-unquote anti-slavery. I ain't even going to say it was anti-slavery, but, just to be on the opposite side of the spectrum.
Yeah.
If the Democrats was pro-slavery, then that would render the Republicans as anti-slavery. But now they did the whole switcheroo. And we all fucked up in the game.
Right, right.
All this shit is fake, man. All this shit is fake. It's all a sham. All of them.
So I say all that to say this. How do we maintain our mental state when we know for a fact that it sounds paranoid, but everything is out to get us, and there's nothing that we could do but just keep on grinding, keep on trying, keep on pushing. And it's like, what is, like, how can someone stay sane knowing and having evidence that this whole shit is against us, and that's why I wanted to talk about your project Clinical and what that meant, and what do you think about the state of Black people understanding mental health and understanding how it can be important for us to be able to see, and what drove you to create an album that has such strong imagery for this, you know, when you say clinical, are you talking about a person who is mentally insane?
Well, in a way, you know, clinical is pretty much, I was trying to explain from a concept of mental health in a way. You see what I'm saying? Like, if you look at the cover,
yeah,
you know, I got the chair with the straps on it and all that, and it looked like an abandoned hospital or stuff like that.
Right.
You know? And if you listen to it, especially in the intro, you can hear what I was kind of going for.
Right.
It sounded like I was, you know, in a padded room, bugging out, mm-hmm. talking to people, voices, all kinds of stuff like that.
Right, right.
You see what I'm saying? That's what I was going for. But as far as the Black community is concerned, if you look at it, like, I guarantee, I don't know the exact numbers, the statistics on this right here, but I guarantee that the inner city and the places where, you know, Black people, you know, where we reside the most, has the most undiagnosed cases of mental illness. I guarantee it. I guarantee it, whether it be post-traumatic stress disorder or just everything that we've had to endure throughout all the years that's passed down generation to generation, whether it be, you know, the stuff with the police now, or, you know, Jim Crow and slavery, and this has been going on for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, so you know that had a psychological effect on our people.
Mm.
And if you look at the type of people that we are, we've always, you know, expressed ourselves and vented and, you know, used different avenues therapeutically, such as music or sports or dancing or something like that. Any kind of art, really. All the art, should I say.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? So, as far as what we could do to try to maintain out here, you got to just really focus on you and your family, find you that one way that you could express yourself, because the first thing they're going to try to do is, if you do go get help, they're going to try to put you on some pills or do something like that. I've been through all that.
Yeah.
I've been through all that. I've been through the institutions. I've been through having to take several different medications for a long period of time. I've been through the adverse effects and the lawsuits and all that.
Hmm.
You see what I'm saying? That shit right there, it ain't no good for you. There's always some kind of natural way to do the same exact things that you look into these concoctions that these scientists made in the lab. You can get the same thing from some natural resource.
Right.
All you got to do is do some research, some reading. I mean, think about it. The human race has been around for centuries and centuries and centuries before medicine came into the picture.
Mm. And we were able to cope.
Exactly. With natural shit. Right. You know what I'm saying? There was no Ritalin 500 years ago.
Right, right, right.
And 500 years ago was what, 1500? That wasn't even that long ago.
Right.
Imagine thousands of years ago, they was using natural shit, doing different things in different cultures and stuff, trying to heal themselves of different things that they thought they knew about, even if they didn't have a full idea of what it was that they were looking at or what they was dealing with. You see what I'm saying? They did different cultural practices just to be able to cope with these problems.
And I think that the reason why a lot of people were happy in spite of being poor and being out out of touch with what one would consume like a Western standard of luxury and comfort and convenience, was because there was a routine. You get up and you work, and it's physical work, and it's moving, and it's shaking, and there's a community, and everyone works together, and there's no individuality in a sense where, yeah, there are people who have individuality and who are unique, but you have to move as a whole, as a unit. And I feel that being a part of something, even if it's a small scale, makes you feel good. And what's happening with this capitalist society that we've created, it's almost like, you know, every man for themselves, and then the big wigs are on the top, and then they just kind of move you over to the left, and they move you over to the right. but you're really not part of it, and they try to create the illusion that you're part of the community. You ever work in a corporate office, they often like to say family. They often like to you know, do gatherings and try to, you know, boost morale by making it seem like you're really, your position really matters, and you're, you know, but if you, you know, decided that you wanted to quit, they would find a way to be able to function without you literally within 24 to 48 hours.
Yeah, they replace you so quick.
Quickly. So you're not really a part of what's happening. And me personally, I want to be a good employee because I understand that that's a good asset to have and to be able to understand how to work with people. But, and I'm not trying to be abrasive or be an asshole when I'm in the workspace, but I do peep it. I do notice when they're trying very hard to basically control you, to control your mind and make you feel important when you're not really that important.
Exactly. They just using you. Huh. As it goes right back to what I said before, that all this shit is a sham, man. Like, the world in general is a facade. Hmm. Like, it's like the Matrix was a prophetic movie, you know?
You know what? I still haven't watched it. I started watching the first, like, few minutes, and then I fell asleep. I want to watch it. I know people will be like, oh, my God. That's the whole purpose of the Late Bloomer podcast, basically, that, you know, there's a lot of shit that I should have seen a long time ago that I haven't seen, and then I want to watch it, like I had never watched it before, and then review it, but it started to become more, like, political and more, like, you know, commentary for the podcast portion of it, but... yeah, The Matrix is going to be one. Purple Rain, I just watched that. It's going to be one. There's a lot of shit. I mean, I just talked about that earlier, Purple Rain. But yeah, man.
The Matrix, that's it right there.
Yeah.
Is profound. Hmm. This right there is crazy, man. Especially considering the shit that we talk about right now.
Yeah.
About how everything in the world is, it's not what you think it is and what you see and what you hear and all that shit. All that shit is this. It's not real. There's an underlying, the real shit is the shit you don't see. You see what I'm saying? It's like you in a program.
Yeah. Well,
and like you got wires and shit connected to you, and you in a computer simulation type shit.
Right.
You see what I'm saying? And right. You think the computer simulation is real life. Well, yeah. What's real life is the fact that your ass is sitting on a bed and on a gurney somewhere with wires connected to you, and your consciousness is uploaded to a damn computer, and that's what you, and that shit has whatever they program in there.
Yeah.
Like with the media and everything, whatever they program in there, that's what you gonna think reality is.
Right. And so that's the thing with me is, like, I know a lot about what's happening around me. Like, I peep game, right? The problem is that I have to play the game with them. If I don't play along, then I cannot succeed. I've tried. Trust me. That's the whole reason why my marriage fell apart. That's the whole reason why I'm 33 and my music hasn't taken off to the level that I've wanted it to reach. It's because I know that I have to play the game in the manner that they have set it up. And if I show any inkling of a different thought or a unique thought, that I'm not going to stand firm and get support that I need. I have to show signs that I'm with the game. And I think that this is why I support hip hop music and the expression of the art form of music in general, because it's like the one last thread to that existence of being able to create your own world out of your thoughts and not have to deal with playing the game with everyone. You can't. Like, I really have no interest in financial anything. And I'm learning that that's not good. And I have to understand 401ks and, you know, I have to understand stocks and bonds. I have to understand how credit works and loans and things of that nature. But I really have no interest in it. If it was up to me and I didn't have to make 40 to 50K a year to survive, I literally would be able to survive off of 10, 11K. You know, I don't need a bunch of furniture, a big fancy house. Like, I don't understand this whole extravagant lifestyle. I get it. I love luxury. I would like to have luxury. But something about it makes me feel empty. And something about struggle makes me feel good. And it sounds crazy, but the happiest people I've seen is the man in the bush in Jamaica.
Yeah, I feel you on that.
With a tent and, you know, dirty and just like, you know, has to wash, you know, doesn't get the luxuries that we have, you know, washing in the ocean and in the water. But, you know, I don't know. I just don't know, bro. I don't know.
You know, that's the problem. The love of money and just the need for finances and all that stuff, it killed the soul of everything. Like, as if you think about it.
It tried. I don't think it killed it yet.
Well, it's damn sure in critical condition. I tell you that. this is what I mean.
Yeah.
Like, the rap game, for instance.
Yeah.
The problem with the creativity in the rap game, not saying that it's not creative or it's not good right now, because it's just as much good shit as, you know, around now, that's always been around, even in the golden era. To me, the golden era was the 90s. But either way it goes, it's out there. All that shit is out there. You still got good shit, but it's just the stuff that they promoting to people, the stuff that they push into people's face and stuff, it just seems to be the same type of shit.
Yeah.
So people seem to say, oh, you know, hip-hop is dead and all that other shit. But it's still there. It's still alive. It's just in the underground. But the problem with the rap game right now, creatively, is the fact that it's filled with hustlers instead of being filled with artists.
Mm.
You see what I'm saying? People
yeah.
in it for the check. People in it for the money.
Right. But I said this before and I'm going to say it again. I genuinely think that while they do try to push this stuff that's, you know, not the art form in its true form, that, you know, while they've tried, that hip hop at its core and where it stands still today, to this day, internationally, it is still very much what it was, even though, like you said, you know, they're trying to push something else that it's not. So I genuinely, genuinely think, and I said this before, that this is the last art form left that hasn't been tainted or hasn't been destroyed or broken down by white supremacy or the structure of it.
You don't think it's been affected by it at all?
Affected by it, but I don't think it's broken it down. I don't think, just like how Cole said, when you go on the jazz page or you go on the rock page, that it's all white people on the front page of Apple Music. I don't think that that's going to happen. Like, one day you're going to wake up or go on the front page of Apple Music on hip hop and see all white faces. I just don't see that happening.
I mean, maybe not all white faces, but, like, for instance, we all know Eminem is nice.
Yeah. He's nice.
He can spit. Take that away
from yeah, definitely.
But him being white made it easier for them to push him to the front as far as with all the promotions and doing all that. So it was like the great white hope.
Right.
In hip hop. Because the fact that there's mad white people in hip hop before Eminem, but he's one that's actually super duper dope and that's nice. And so he's like that shit. And then you got people like Post Malone, who's like about to pass all kinds of people on the ladder, on the list, as far as how many hits he got. That nigga keep coming out with hit after hit after hit. And the whole reason he said, I seen an interview where he said that he was just making hip hop songs because it was easy. He didn't even like hip hop. He was trying to get on like that. But when he got on, he was going to go back to making the other kind of music that he likes to make.
Yeah.
He tried to do that shit. That shit didn't work out. Came right back to hip hop.
Right. Right. Right.
You know what I'm saying? So it's shit like that. You see what I'm saying? There's a lot of people. And then, not to mention, behind the scenes is like 95% white.
Right, right, right. The videographers, the producers, the
record labels.
Yeah, the labels. The makeup. Yeah, the media. Executives. Right, right. The executives on the radio stations, the executives on, like, the vlogs and the video entertainment sites like Revolt and other things, they have, you know, largely white staff, yeah.
Exactly, and the thing is, half of these niggas don't know the first thing about the culture.
Right, right, but some of them, but I give this to that, some of them know more about hip-hop than, you know, the average hip-hop listener, which is interesting.
Yeah, I agree with you on
yeah.
that. I know a couple, like, if you really look at it,
yeah.
across these,
yeah.
got an appreciation for the hip-hop culture that America does not have no more.
Right, right. I watch the way that these Vox reporters break down the shit. It's like, what it's interesting and it's good watching these videos, but it's also kind of scary because it's almost like they're studying us so that they can utilize the tools.
Yeah, they've been doing that from
Yeah, because I can't tell at sometimes if it's because they're genuinely interested and respect the art, or if they're really trying to understand how we ended up doing it. How did you do that?
Look, that's what it is. Black people are like a marvel.
Yeah.
Like, we're like a marvel. People want to look at us, try to get into our psyche, see what makes us tick, see how we do the things that we do, and shit. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Trying to get a part of it, you know?
Damn.
That's our greatness, man.
Damn.
That's our greatness, and we can't forget that shit. You know what I'm saying? And we also got to realize that when people get interested, for the most part, it's not 100%, but when people get interested in that part of us, it's not with pure intentions. You have cases where it is. I'm not saying, you know, I'm not making it, you know, universal or whatever, but for the most part, these people, it's all for their own gain. It's all for their own gain, man.
Wow.
That's the truth right there. We have to realize that. So tread lightly. Understand you got to make certain moves and make certain connections, deal with certain people. It's all good. Do what you got to do, but just don't be fooled by this bullshit out here, yo.
Damn. Well, I think that we can close off on that, because this is an extra bonus on the end of the podcast, and we're exceeding 100 minutes right now. So I'm going to post on the YouTube link the album Clinical, and people can get that on Bandcamp.
PureCompMusic.com.
PureCompMusic.com, and you can also just Google PureComp, no spaces, and you'll get him. PureComp. And it'll pop up right on the first result on Google.
Yeah, no doubt, man. Y'all get that clinical. PureCompMusic.com, man. Follow me on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, all that good stuff. I'm on your streaming services, Spotify, iTunes, Tidal, Google Play, all that stuff, man. Holla at me. I'm out here.
All right. Bet.
Keeping it organic.